Sum is what we are going to talk about. Fine. So, before we go into some conceptual discussion regarding the codes, let's have a basic understanding on these two terms. What do you mean by a signal and what do you mean by a system? See, these two words, signal and system, we very frequently use in life. Let's say you are talking in mobile phone in your in a building, and in between if the voice is breaking off, you are saying that signal is not coming. Similarly, let's say you are waiting for a train in a railway station, and if the train is getting delayed, you say there is a problem in the railway system itself. So I mean that these are two commonly used words in English. We almost everyone use these two words. But to give a definition of the signal and system, we should stick into something, or we should prefer something that will mostly suitable for our course. That is the course of signal system with respect to ECE, electrical instrumentation, or with respect to engineering, or with respect to gate exam point of view. So let us understand what do you mean by a signal and what do you mean by a system. The most simple way to define a signal is any quantity that carries some information can be regarded as signal. I will write the statement whatever you needed to write in your note. First listen carefully. Any quantity that carries some information can be regarded as signal. Okay. So what are the example of signal? How do I justify my statements? I can say that the output of transducers, human voice or human speech, right? Then video signal, photograph, etc. These are all form of signals. But as I am saying that it is something that contains some information. How do I justify this statement? See, for example, if you are going to a doctor's, immediately is putting the thermometer and checking your body temperature. Depending on how much it is a 98.4 degree Fahrenheit or 100 degree 120, 102, whatever. Based on that, he is giving you some medicines and all, right? So this is a transducer. Thermometer is a temperature transducer, which is giving the information regarding the temperature of body, is it not? So we can say the output of transducer is containing information. So we can say that output of transducer is signal. Human speech, whatever the lectures I am delivering to you, right? It is again containing some informations. But one point is, you need to understand that whatever I am saying you, like if you talk something, so you should not understand one thing, that whatever the information is containing, your speech is containing, that need not be always important. I mean to say, it's not like that I am delivering the lectures, only then it is containing information. No, in day-to-day life, if you talk to your family or your friends, whatever it may be, whenever you talk something, it is containing some information. Let's say you are saying hi. Hi is also a form of information, isn't it? Yes. Video signal is again containing information. Let's say you are watching some news channel, some movies, some cricket match. Again, these are the form of information. Photograph. Just while looking into a photograph, you say that this person is some cricketer, some president or something, or this particular temple, something kind of information you say just by looking a photograph. So these all are in the form of, these are containing information. So we should say that these all are the example of signals. So let me note down this point. So these are the example of signal. So how to define this? Any quantity that carries information. So initial 1 hour will be introduction to the course. After 1 hour, we'll enter into some conceptual discussions. Any quantity that carries information can be regarded as signal, or these are the form of signal. So these are the example of signals, right? Then what do you mean by a system? So how to define the system? So system, we can say that these are the collection of various components put it together to serve a particular purpose, and that particular purpose in technically we say this is processing of signals. I'll write the statement first reason. Signal is the form of information. System is the collection of components put it together to process the signal. Then when I say process the signal, then definitely the question that should strike to your mind is, why do we need the signal processing, or what is the meaning of signal processing? So the simple answer for this one is, processing is needed to obtain the signal in more desirable form. Processing is needed to obtain the signal in more desirable form. How do I justify this statement? Okay, imagine a situation, this is of course an online class. Let's say I am going to teach you physical in a class. Let's say class size is very big. Let's say 200, 300 students are there, right? Or forget these things. Let's say during election days, you might have seen various politicians come for election campaigning, right? So do they use sound system or not? Of course. If they don't use the sound system, if directly they will start saying, so what will happen? The people who are in the, that great crowd, the voice of that politician may not be audible to them. So to send that voice signal of politician, whatever he is saying, in a more desirable form, sound systems are being installed in big conference hall or wherever huge crowd is there. Is it not? In fact, even if I am standing at the studio at Hyderabad now, throughout the country, wherever you are sitting in front of system, you are able to listen my voice, you are able to see me. It's all because we are processing that some instruments, some equipments are here, like cameras, these microphones, Bluetooth headset, etc., etc. A lot of things are there. These all are being put together to 67 out of. So this is all the topper mark in 2012. But if you compare 13, 14, 15, all are 90 plus out of 100. Okay, the reason like why this is 2012 this much and why the remaining years we are getting 90 plus topper mark is the paper level itself was this much tough. It was very tough paper in the entire history, 2012. You take any subject, there are very rare questions which are the usual models. In networks I have shown, some questions I'll solve it. But thing is, you take any course, all questions are not regular model. So that's why this is, everything is relative. So what you should understand is, if you are feeling something tough and if your preparation is up to the mark, that toughness feeling will come to each and every student. It's not the you only that who is feeling that. See the topper mark 67, why the topper mark 90 plus? Because the fellow who secured this mark, he also feels the paper is tough. Otherwise the mark would have been around 90 range. It's not happening. So you need to understand 100% perfection, if you can do it's okay, but you should not be disappointed if it is not happening. Okay. But not to worry about this. Don't scare by you looking this 90 mark. But if you come to a mark which is around 60, if you come to 60 mark in EC, the rank is around 300. If you come to 65, the mark is, it is within 200. You will be surprised. If you have some friends and some other sources, or you can check in Google also, like EC recent like 2014-15 statistic you check, 65 mark if you secure, your rank is, it's around 200. So what I want to say is, out of 100 if you are 60, securing 65, still you have 35 mark tolerance range. And where this 35 is going? Yes, 35, there is some tolerance band. As I said, 100% perfection is not possible, right? So there is a tolerance limit. 35 is a huge gap, I guess, right? So you should try your best, but sometime you should not be disappointed, like we are unable to solve few problems. It will happen, right? Because somewhere back, I was also students. So the same feeling comes. So you should not be disappointed by looking into these all things. So like I say in other courses also, again the same thing. My limit is, my boundary is gate course. And I suggest you or advise you, whatever you can say, like you also limit yourself in the gate question bank itself. If you have time, practice any books if you want. But ultimately, all that matters that whether after preparing for gate, whether you are getting a good rank or not. That is what the success means. You need to get a good rank to go into MTech, into some institutes or PSUs or whatever scopes are there of gates. So the ultimate thing is, goal is, you need to have a good rank. So exam oriented study is very crucial, right? So to learn the concepts and all, if you are interested very much in any course, entire life is there. But this time you should be purely exam oriented, because you are not going to learn only one subject. 10 subject you have to learn and you have to answer that within 3 hours. So be exam oriented. But how do you believe me? Like if I teach, I have seen many times people ask, sir, whatever you teach, is your note is sufficient for gate exam questions and all? Like this, when I go, like maybe it's online class, I didn't get these kind of things. But if you see, if physical class when I go, people used to ask, is it sufficient? These are they ask. So how do you believe me then? So the best thing is, you listen the lectures, any particular chapters what I say, and I'll solve a couple of problems. After that, you take the previous year gate question bank of PCE electrical or IES question or any standard book you take. You take any problems, so most of the questions, you will be in a position to answer that. 100% is again not possible, but yes, I can assure that 90% question you should be answering. But how do you know your preparation is going in the right path? After listening any chapters, let's say Fourier transform is completed. So whatever I taught here, Fourier transforms. After that, go through the previous year question bank. In the first attempt itself, if you are solving 70% of the problems, this is a very nice preparation, I would say. 70% will happen first time. If you try repeated practice, it will come up to 90. If we are going to 90 range, I can go up to 95. So I have also 5% tolerance band, right? So some questions are there which are very weird. Let's say like this year, if you see in 2015 in control system, there is a question in electrical which is come from discrete time control systems. That question I tried minimum 10 times, but I am not even getting the thought. It's not only me. I consulted many other persons also who are very much experienced. So no one is able to give a satisfactory answer for that. So something is there that everyone feels. So you should not be thinking like this question I am unable to solve means you are losing confidence. If you think like this, this is not good, this is not the right approach. That's what I want to say. So the approach would be same, like I'll be telling concepts with respect to that concept. I'll be solving the previous year gate problems, which are taken from ECE, electrical instrumentation, and some of them are from the previous year IS, and very few questions I have taken from some of the standard books. I'll tell those books names also. Let's see the syllabus that we are going to talk about in the course. And what is the importance of this course? Like as I said, if you remember, there are two courses. One is network theory and one is signal systems, which are the most fundamental course to have a clear understanding on the remaining subjects. Even if you are electrical students, so like in your power electronics and your electrical machines, you say this harmonic, higher harmonics are present, this harmonics, you talk regarding harmonics. So you need Fourier concept here. ECE, without signal system, you don't have anything in communications, right? In fact, if you see some analog questions and some digital questions are also nowadays they are giving with respect to linking the multiple subjects. So these and networks should be very clear to have a clear understanding or depth understanding on the other subject also. And like the most good thing that is a benefit to all the students today is, see, GATE exam, it's started around 1986 like that, right? Almost 30 years over. But if you see the syllabus, like what was there in 1986 and what is there in 2015, of course this year they have made some minute changes, but if you see 98% or 95% of the syllabus is almost same. So why this is advantage I am saying this one is, in this almost 30 year of span, they have not left a single concept. Any concept you read from any book, you will definitely find some good questions in GATE exams. So what I want to say is that you take any year problems, any year paper, any stream you take, you will find that nowadays particularly the stream from 2013, 14, 15, almost 50 to 60% of the problems are previous year repeated model. Of course, you don't get as it is, but conceptual wise you don't find, oh, this is totally new, I never heard this. These things are not happening nowadays. So that's the reason I always say you please concentrate on the GATE exams. Recently also, if some of you are attending some other exams, some PSUs or some state level technical exam, you see that lot of questions are all again the standard things only. Like if you have solved the previous year questions of GATE, so most of the question have been standard exam also copying the question from the GATE previous years. So that is true, and you can check if you have some resources. So that's the point. 60% questions is almost previous year model. And there are some questions they are giving nowadays by linking multiple subjects. If you have grip on multiple subjects, then only you can answer. And there are again some questions which are purely analysis based. Like you cannot find those things normally in the books, or no one can teach that. So they frame that question in an analysis based. So whatever concept you learn in the class, that's your capability, that how much you can think to answer that. So those questions are also coming. So right, so as I said, there is a 35 mark tolerance band, like 65 mark is a really very good mark. 35 mark means you have lot of scope, right? So some questions will be there, you should not be worried about that, right? You need not be secure 100 out of 100 to get a good rank. And surprisingly, like the same statistic is almost same in electrical also. For electrical, if you see, I am saying 65, for electrical, you reduce 10 more marks. 55 mark if you secure, whatever I told, it is almost everything true. 55 is a very good mark. And surprisingly, like if you see the previous year, like GATE exam, like the website, that out of 2.5 lakh students attending in the GATE exam in ECE, hardly 10,000 students are qualifying the GATE exams. Out of 2.5 lakhs, 10,000 are qualifying, who are securing 25 plus mark. So you should not be worried about looking the crowd, 2.5 lakhs people are there, how I'll get ranks. So ultimate thing is, your goal is 65 marks. You think the mark, don't see the crowds and all, it will unnecessarily demotivate you. These all things I'm telling from my experience, like when I was also preparing, I was also think this much crowd, these, that. But that is not the thing that you should be worried about. So very less people are there who really dedicatedly prepare this. And that the thing who maintain up to the end points. So they used to click. Anyway, lot of story I told. So let's start. Let me give the course like the way that the sequence I am going to follow. So whatever given in syllabus, I'll read each and every statement after writing these chapters. So let me tell like what is the sequence on which I am going to teach you. So first we'll start with fundamentals of signals. In each course, this is the first thing that you should be clear, fundamentals of signals. So what we'll be discussing on the fundamental chapter is scaling, shifting, the definition of various signal, what is impulse signal, step signals, what is rectangular pulse, triangular pulse, some standard things you should know from these particular chapters, even if you don't get direct question too much, but to understand the remaining chapter, so understanding of this is very crucial. So we'll take up this and we'll spend a sufficient amount of time to understand these things. Then we'll see classification of signals. When I say classification of signal, so we are going to see like how to say signal is energy signal, power signal, periodic, non-periodic, even signal, odd signal, causal, non-causal, bounded, unbounded. So there are 7-8 varieties are there. So all the stuffs I'll discuss on this. Then classification of systems. So you might have seen the questions like linear system, non-linear systems, time invariant, time variant, stable, unstable, causal system, non-causal system, invertible, non-invertible, static dynamics. So there are 6 varieties. So we'll see on this. The fourth one is LTI systems. So you might have heard terms like convolutions, right? And in fact, every year we are getting questions. I'll tell how the questions coming from which chapters and all. So LTI systems, our major concentration is convolution along with some supported properties and applications. And the real thing start from here of signal system, which is Fourier series. Of course, for continuous time, I'm writing CTFS, right? So let me write shortly. Continuous time Fourier series. Discrete time Fourier series, they have removed from syllabus this year. Earlier in electrical, it was not there. In EC, it was there. So they were asking the question in 14 and 15 also they have asked, but this year, in the modified syllabus, DTFS is removed. So after this, we'll have a chapters continuous time Fourier transforms. Then we'll have Laplace transforms. Sorry, after this, seventh one I would say it is sampling theorems, which is a application of Fourier transforms. And finally, we'll have Laplace transforms and Z transforms. Let me complete. This is the syllabus is common in ECE and electrical. And electrical syllabus is this. I'll read the syllabus what they have given. Wait. So this is the total thing of electrical syllabus. It is also in the ECE. But apart from this, in ECE we have DTFT, discrete time Fourier transforms, DFT, and FFT. And this year they have introduced something known as system realization, like series form, parallel form. So there are some forms are there, realization. In fact, even it was not in course last year, before that also they have asked, but in any way you need not to have some depth study about this. If you have little bit background knowledge from your from your control system block diagram algebra, you can answer all these questions. Only thing is there you're using the S notation. Here you have to use the Z notations. So like they will be giving a block diagram, they will be asking what is the transfer function, what is this ratio to that ratio. So some algebraic manipulation you have to do. So anyway, they have particularly mentioned this time. So we'll see some stuff related to this. And one more thing also they have introduced digital filter designs. So if you see the various books available on the course, filter design itself, you will find different books. So is a huge area of filter designs. So particularly who are going to M.Tech for signal processings, and also they have a chapter filter design, the course. So we'll see some basics of that. I'll introduce all those things in DTFT chapters. So basics of filters, like In networks, you have studied like how to identify a system, a filter is low pass, high pass, band stop. So like this, in digital domain, how to identify what kind of filter is it. And some later stuff I'll discuss there. So these are the things we have extra only in ECE and instrumentation, whoever are there also this is mentioned. But electrical, this is what your course is, this much of chapters. But even if these are the things, how much marks you are getting? Every year, 10 to 12 marks you are getting from this. 10 minimum, maximum 12 we are getting. And if you see all the previous year questions, electrical, of course, all 10 marks you will get from these electrical people. And this is for electrical, all 10 marks. And if I talk regarding ECE, many times it happened that all 10 mark questions come from these sections only, right? But nowadays, almost from 2014 and 15, they are giving one question from this DFT. FFT also will see some basics. So what I want to say is, our major concentration on these chapters only. Our major concentration is only on these chapters. So these things, I will cover this, but mostly what is will be there, like most of the time we are getting the question, including 2015 also papers, but we will have a look on all these also, right? Fine. Now, truly speaking, if you see this 2014 and 15, particularly apart from these all chapters, from this chapter the questions are, they are framing some new model questions. Like if you see the earlier days questions, like most of the questions are based on ROC. So they will be giving some impulse response or some transfer function. They will be asking causality, stability by mentioning some ROC concepts. So those model questions are also coming, but very less. Nowadays they are focusing new problems on this. As we'll proceed, I'll solve few of them. Laplace transform is this year in ECE they have removed actually in signals. But without have a depth of this knowledge, we cannot understand this. So we'll cover this also. In fact, I'll tell you one thing. I'm telling you from beginning, this is the chapters you need to understand. If you understand this chapter clearly, like there are lot many properties. So if you understand the properties, if you remember this, understanding of Laplace, Z, DTFT, DFT, almost same. So like in networks, if you know the DC network analysis, like if you know how to write nodal, mesh, Thevenin theorem, etc. in DC itself, then AC you can understand very easily. Only thing you need to understand is phasor. Exactly in a similar way here also, that if you understand this particular chapters, understanding of Laplace, Z, DTFT, DFT is pretty much similar. Rarely there are very few differences are there. Otherwise, almost everything is same. Right. So, we'll see that. So, this is what the structures. And ECE people particularly, I am truly saying, like if you compare the electrical paper and ECE papers, electrical paper levels are good compared to ECE. Like of course this is not there in electrical, but if you compare the questions from the initial chapters, you will feel that compared to ECE, electrical papers are of good levels. So don't differentiate yourself, like you are electrical means you have to solve only electrical. Solve ECE also, if you are ECE solve electrical also, instruments also you solve. So try to solve a maximum number of questions from the previous years. Many ask, sir, what book will follow? Of course, I will tell that. But the point is, so when you ask me to, like from which book we should practice problems. So I would say like you take any standard book, practice those things. But point why I am not saying like any book you have to follow if you read this, everything you can answer. Because any book you take, any foreign author books, they are not writing the book from gate exam point of view. Gate orientation is different, you know, like always conceptual approach, logical approach. So those all collection will not find a single book. So that's the reason I say always follow the previous year questions. If you are having time after solving gate questions, solve IS questions also. But gate question is the maximum level. If you are solving that confidently, at least 70 to 80%, your preparation is done. That you should understand. That is what your benchmark, previous year gate question max. Okay. So coming to electrical, out of the 10 marks, from these you are getting 2 mark questions. In fact, in ECE instrument is also same. LTI system one 2 mark question or 1 mark question compulsorily, some based on some properties or they will be giving some signals. Continuous time Fourier series is also 2-mark question, particularly electrical. From last 2 years, they are giving very awesome question on this CTFS based on symmetry properties. And this is the most crucial chapters, almost you may not get a question here, but here very crucial. This is also 2 marks you can expect. And remaining from these, you will have another 2-mark questions. So almost uniformly distributed. And ECE you can expect from these alls, another 2 marks you can guess. It's a rough estimation by looking into the previous year question papers. Right? So this is the approach. Like, we need to understand concepts, and after that I'll take up the problems on previous year gate. After listening the lectures, this is what the thing you need to do. And yes, what is my role on this particular course is, see, the students who are already good in the course, right, like if you have studied really well in the your BTEC days, right, so you should learn how to take the approach to a problems. My intention here is, I am very sure like every one of you have already studied the signal system at least once in your semester course. Most of the problems you might have solved using the integrations, like a lot of integrations, most of the things Fourier transform also only integrations. But here the thing that I would try my best is how to avoid the integrations. Without doing integration just by physical interpretation or by using some properties, how to solve the time consuming complicated problems. So that's what I should try, like how to avoid the integrations. So Fourier transforms is a huge topic, like most of the problems you might have solved using the normal integration approach. But I'm telling from beginnings, so whatever problem I'll solve, not more than 2 to 3 integration I'll do. In the entire course, if you calculate from the beginning to end, so hardly not more than 7 to 8 integration I'll do in the entire course. So in fact, gate orientation is that, it's their intention is not to kill your time by asking big integrations. So just some properties that you should understand. And what is the overview of the course is, like let's say networks, you don't have much stress to remember a lot of things except the 2-port network and resonance, similarly digital also like that. But coming to these, here there are a lot of things really you need to remember. By repeated practice only you have to do that. Let's say LTI system or convolution chapters, a huge number of properties are there. Fourier transform, huge number of properties are there. In fact, everywhere if you remember the standard relations, then only your problem solving speed will be increased. And that will not happen in a single day. You have to do repeated practice. Fine. So, this is what the introduction to the course. So, let's try to start on this course. So, let's see classification of signals. And whatever I have written in this, the board, the syllabus also, if you want, you can cross-check. You can download the gate website. From gate website itself, you can download your this syllabus and you can check all chapters I have given here. So this is the sequence you are going to follow. So whatever it is, so let's understand. So mostly, so broadly, we divide the signals into two categories. One is known as analog signal, and second category known as digital signals. So these definitions you will be not be asking, anyone will not ask you, but we need to understand everything so to answer the problems in the consequence chapters. So as I said that we have a separate chapter for signals, like where we'll discuss periodic, non-periodic, power, energy, even odd, etc., all those things. But this is what like a introductory concepts to the course. So let's see, there are various ways to define the signals, like signal can be classified in the analog signal and digital signals, and they can be classified as one dimensional signal, multidimensional signals. But whatever is needed for us, let's try to understand that. So when I say analog signal, this analog signal is of two kinds. This could be a continuous type. I am saying continuous type, I am not saying continuous time. And it could be a discrete type. Discrete type signals. But before that, let me tell one more thing. So this is based on classification of signal. So this is based on two categories I want to discuss actually. This is based on amplitude of the signals. I'll come why is it so. Amplitude of signals. Second category that I want to discuss, classification of signal. You put heading classification of signal and two categories based on amplitude of signals, and second one is based on independent variable of the signal. Based on independent variable of signals. So let's try to understand these two things. So how do you classify the signal based on amplitude? How do you classify the signals based on the independent variables? See, let me come to this first. In fact, you can make this is A and this one is B, right? So let's see this. Any waveform you draw, let's say I'm asking you to drawing a sinusoidal waveforms. So you'll be drawing a waveform which is something looking like this, is it not? In general, what you say, we say this is time axis T, and depending on this is voltage or current, you write here this is either Vm or you write minus Vm. So here I would say that this is what a one dimensional signal, because the number of independent variable is only one. That is, variation of voltage signal we are saving with respect to time. So one dimensional signals. But it is not necessary that all the signals will be one dimensional signals. So there could be two dimensional signals, three dimensional signals, and four dimensional signals. So when I said dimension, dimension means how many number of independent variables I am using to represent a signal. So to of course to indicate a voltage variation or current variation with respect to time, I am using only one independent variables. So I would say that it is a one dimensional signal because I am using only one independent variables. But now let's say, for example, as I said, the various example of the signals are photograph, video, etc. See, if I take a photograph examples, so right, you know that the photograph comprises of various pixels like this, you'll have various pixels, is it not? Okay, forget about the, let's talk in a simpler way. If you take a photograph, so you have seen, let's say I'm considering color as my information, right, color. Let's say this is the function I'm interested, color. So color is the signal I'm interested of a photograph. So if I move in this photograph from point to point, color will keep on changing with respect to x and y coordinates, is it not? So let's say this is my x coordinate, this is my y coordinates. So if you ask what is the color at any point if I take, color will be changing. Here it may be black, white, red, green, anything else. So color is function of x and y. So I can say that color is depending on two variables x and y. So this is a two-dimensional signal. Now if I bring a moving pictures or a videos, so it is a three-dimensional signal. How do I say that? What is a video actually? Video is nothing but a moving pictures. So along with x and y, you'll have time will also come into pictures. So video is a three-dimensional signal where the independent variable are x and y and t. If you take a TV screen particular, let's say, you take any point on TV screen, let's say again I'm considering the color of a videos that changes with respect to the points where, and of course with respect to time, because the video changes with respect to the moving pictures. So this is the example of three-dimensional signals. Room temperature can be regarded as a four-dimensional signals. Room temperature can be regarded as four-dimensional signal. How? This is a function of x, y, z and time t. So let's say you are measuring your room temperature, right? Any point you take in your room, it is having some coordinate x, y and z, Cartesian coordinate, let's assume. And along with the temperature changes with respect to time, right? Whatever temperature you have on morning, it won't be same on the daytime, it won't be same in the night time. So temperature can be regarded as a four-dimensional signal. This is what one of the IES exam questions. Temperature can be regarded as which of these four-dimensional signals, right? But as far as our course is concerned, not in only in signal system, all subjects of electronics as far as gate is concerned, we are only going to deal with one independent variable signals, right? So these are only some formal definition you should know, but our major concentration is just to deal with one dimensional signals. So again, when I talk one dimensional signals, so based on one independent variables, we are going to talk this. So the usual notation, this is not network course, so we will not follow B, I and I notation. The general things that we will follow is, we will use a notation like x of t and y of t. Normally we will be given some inputs, we will take that as x, some output y t. So this is one popular things, or most of the time we will be following this x omega and y omega. So the point is, how do you differentiate x t and y t, how to x omega, x, y omega, how to get all those things, we will see that. But point you need to understand is, if variation of a signal I am indicating with respect to time, so I would say that it is a time domain signal. And however, if I am showing any signal with respect to some kind of shape with respect to frequencies, we say it is a frequency domain signal. So time domain signal means independent variable is time. Frequency domain signal means independent variable is frequency, omega, or sometime we use F notation also. Technically, the other name of this kind of things is also known as spectrum. And using the Fourier transform concepts, we convert a time domain signal to the frequency domain signals. So using some standard relationship, we'll see that depending on the wave shape, we are going to convert the time domain signal to frequency domain signals. Okay. And here one point also, that in the course, throughoutly if you take any books, we use two words interchangeably, such as function and signals. So if this seems to be same, but there is very small difference exists. See, if the signal is changing with respect to one or more than one independent variables, so anything that changing which is more than one variables or one, those all are the signals. However, if it is changing with respect to only one independent variables, it is said to be functions. That means, as I said, like we are only going to deal with the one independent variable, so by default all kind of wave shape I will talk, those all are the functions. So I would say all one dimensional signals are function, but multi-dimensional signal where the independent variable is 2, 3, 4, etc., they are said to be only signals, they are not functions. So all one independent variable signals are said to be functions. So all functions are signal, all signal need not be functions. So that is what the strict definition, but we will be using these two are interchangeably, keeping in mind that in our course these two are same. Fine, we will see these things. So you need to understand that this is what the classification of signal based on independent variables. One dimensional signal and multi-dimensional signal. One dimensional signal is one where independent variable is one. Multidimensional signal is one where independent variable is more than one, like 2, 3, 4, etc. And by default, we will talk about only one-dimensional signals. Okay. As I said, depending on independent variables, we'll have a time domain signal or frequency domain signals. So now we are classifying this category based on amplitude of the signals. So let me come to the analog signal, then we'll come to digital signals. An analog signal is one that is where there is no bound on the amplitudes. A signal, if it is allowed to take any value of amplitude, is said to be analog signal. For example, let's say this. If I take this, some random variation like this, so let's say constant with respect to time. However, the discussion what I'm doing, those are equally valid with respect to frequency also, right? So let me constant with respect to time. That's why I have not written here continuous time. I can write here continuous time or continuous frequencies. I can write here discrete time or discrete frequencies. I am discussing with respect to continuous. So that is valid for both time as well as frequencies. Okay. See, the point is, if a signal is allowed to take any amplitudes, it is said to be analog signals. Let's say particularly this case, I would say that let's say I am defining the peak amplitude of this one is, let's say this is 7 volts, like a voltage signal I have taken so with respect to times. So if I ask between, this is the at t equal to 0, let's say amplitude is zeros. So between 0 to 7 volts, how many values are there? Your answer is infinite. 0.1 volts, 0.15 volts, 0.124 volts, like this. If I ask how many number of voltages are there, so you will say that there are infinite number of levels are there. That is what the meaning of analog signal. The analog signal is allowed to take any value of amplitudes between this minimum and maximum. It can take any. We are not saying that it should not take 6.8, it should not take 6.9, it should not take a negative value. We don't have any restriction. So a signal where there is in amplitude there is no restriction, we allowed to take any value, it is said to be analog signal. That is in general definition. But how do you differentiate this continuous and this discrete? So this classification we are doing with respect to independent variables. So if this independent variable, let's say for example time, if it is continuous in nature, we will say that it is a continuous time signal. However, if I change it to omega, I will say that it is a continuous frequency signal, right? So then if this is continuous, what is discrete? Then I would say the signal which is not continuous, but that is analog signal, that is discrete signals. Okay. See, let me elaborate this point. So when I say continuous time analog signal, you need to understand that for all value of time, let's say t equal to 0, t equal to 0.7 second, t equal to 1 second, t equal to 1.4 second, any amount of time you take, the signal is defined. I mean, you will have an amplitude with respect to all value of times. That is what we mean by the continuous time signal. But the problem is, all the, in the practical life, the DSP processor, they are not at all sensitive to this kind of signals. So you need to convert this signal into some forms that DSP processor can process all those things. So by doing some certain kind of processing, we are simply discretizing this particular time axis. We are not putting any restriction on the amplitude. We are simply discretizing this time axis. And the resulting signal what you are getting, that is known as a discrete time signals. So when I say discrete means, which is not continuous, that is said to be discrete signals. So let's say, like, how we get this discrete time signal from continuous time signal is, there is a process called sampling. We'll see that in detail, I have a chapters after Fourier transforms. But for the time being, you take this as a fact. By doing the sampling process, if you apply this particular block to a sampler, a device is their sampler, so what it will produce is, it will produce a signals whose envelope will look like this. So like this, this will produce a signals. So you can see here, like if I compare these two signals, so what I will get, what I can see is that wherever the signal was continuous like this, now I don't have any restriction on the amplitudes. So you may be asking, if I denote this particular signal by x of t signals, right, what is the notation I should use for this? See here, I am using x of t, I am using a t. But what is the notation for this? The notation for this signal is x of nts, okay? And what is this axis? This axis is nts. Of course, you have studied this is n. I will come to that when it is n, okay? And if you ask me, what are these values? So assuming there is something known as uniform samplings, so we say that, let's say like this, so we will have the values on the integral multiple of the sampling interval. So ts, 2ts, 3ts, 4ts, and so on and so forth. But let's say this is what my ts instant is. If I say my amplitude is here 6.8 volts, so this will be 6.8 volts. It would be 7 volts. It would be 5.6 volts. It would be somewhere like 2.3. This is 3.7 volts. So like this, it can take any values. So what I want to tell you by taking this kind of value here is, we don't have any kind of restriction on the amplitudes. It is, I'm not saying that it has to be integer, it has to be integer. Not like that. So whatever the value amplitude is there, we don't have any restriction on amplitudes. So in that sense, it is analog signal. We don't have any restriction on the amplitudes. For coming to digital, we'll have restrictions, right? So based on amplitude, it is of analog and digital. Analog is with respect to continuous and discrete. Continuous means independent variable axis is continuous. Discrete means independent variable axis is not continuous. This is discrete. Okay. But you need to understand that even if I am using the sampling process and from x of t, I am deriving the signal here x of nts, that usually we don't use this kind of notation of x of nts. But rather than that, instead of x of nts, what you use is, we always use the x of n notation. So what do you understand? What is the meaning of this? So you may be thinking that here, if I say x of nts is x of n, you may be thinking that ts equal to 1 second. Is it so? It's not like that. So you need to understand here that each samples between the difference between each sample, the time gap is TS. If I say this, the time gap is TS, this is TS, 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 everywhere TS, TS. So you need to understand one thing, that we are only for a compact notation, we are not using X of N TS, we are using X of N. So we are simply omitting this TS information here. And if I see this, I will be getting 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and so on and so forth. With assumption that it is a uniform sampling rate that we are using, and that is what true for our particular course. Always we'll assume that uniform sampling rates. So all the samples we are getting on the integral multiple of the sampling time TS. So TS can be any value. It can be 1 second, 1.1 second, 1.9 second, 2.4 second, depending on the signal natures, like using the sampling theorems, FS greater than 2 FMs. We'll see all those things. We get these kind of signals, right? And we intentionally are omitting this notation TS, 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 and we simply write these as some integers, like whatever multiplied to TS. It is understood that the signal is actually one time multiple of TS, two time multiple of TS. So you should not understand, you should not misinterpret this, that TS equal to 1 second always. If you say TS equal to 1 second always, this means the sampling frequency is 1 hertz. If the sampling frequency is 1 hertz for all signals, there may not be any need of sampling theorem today, is it not? So this is a wrong assumption, you should not think in this way. So this is just for a compact notation we are saying like this. And from this point onwards, you should always remember, a discrete time signal is always defined with respect to integer value of n, right? If someone is asking what is this particular time, let's say I'm defining TS equal to 1.5 second, let's say, okay? So strictly saying, this is 1.5 second, this is 3 seconds, this is 4.5 second, this is 6 seconds, so on and so forth, with respect to n TS axis. But if I want to plot this with respect to n itself, it will always give me the integers 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so on and so forth. So here onwards, in any time, that when I write here the integers, you should understand that these are TS notation I have omitted here, right? And the discrete time signal is strictly defined where the n is integers. We don't define this with respect to non-integers because we assume that we have done the uniform samplings. So this is what the meaning of continuous time signal and discrete time signals. However, same thing if I change this omega here also, omega like that, so it will be saying that this is continuous frequency signal, this is discrete frequency signals. Remaining all discussion remains the same things. Okay? So by doing some processing, like by placing a block samplers to this particular signals, we are getting this kind of signals. So once again, we are only discretizing the time axis. We are not putting any restriction on this. However, this particular signals, you are passing through something known as quantizer and an encoder. Quantizer, and it is followed by encoder. If you pass this discrete time signal through these two blocks, whatever the signal we are going to get, that is known as digital signals. So not to go into too much depth of this, you'll be learning all those things, your pulse coded modulation in communications. But just you should take this as the fact that this, the restriction what you're going to put in digital case is that we are not going to allow any kind of amplitudes. We'll be doing some kind of approximation, that is known as quantization. 6.8, I may be doing this as 6.5 volts. That means I'll be restricting that the signal is not allowed to take any value it wants. It has to take only a discrete set of values. Let's say it has to take only 8 values. Any signal which is lying between, let's say, 0 volts to, let's say, 20 volts, this all has to be converted or approximated into some 8 values. It can be 1 volts, 2 volts, like that, some approximations we'll be doing. And after doing that approximation, each particular level is coded into binary form by using different coding scheme. Let's say binary codes or some lot of other kind of coding scheme is there. So after that, we get the signal which you use popular in digital signal, which is having only 2 levels. We say this is digital signals. If you pass the signal through this particular block, quantizers, the output what you're going to see is, you'll be getting output like this, like this, like this you'll be getting. So what I want to say is, the number of levels will not be any values. It will have some finite numbers. So let me be 4, 5, 8, like that. And we are coding each of the levels to get this kind of signal. This is what I mean by the digital signal is. But as far as our course is concerned, we are going to concentrate only on these two categories, continuous and discrete. Digital signals, the processing of these all things you will be learning in the communication course on the various modulation schemes and all. So this is the only fact you should know to understand these things. And here one point you keep in mind, like sometimes gate questions are there, we'll solve that. So they will be giving the statement, a discrete time signal is obtained by sampling a continuous time signals by sampling frequency this much. So whenever they give this kind of statement, this is a very standard substitution. You should remember that whenever a discrete time signal is obtained from a continuous time signal, the replacement that we always make is x of t by x of nts. So that is one crucial point you should understand here. And once again, not to confuse that here the ts is not 1. This is understood that these are existing with respect to integral multiple of ts. Right? So discrete time signal is defined for integer value of n only, whereas continuous time signal, it is defined for all value of amplitude and all value of times. So the very popular statements you might have studied, like a continuous time signal, here you say the continuous time signal definition, what is this? Is continuous in time and amplitudes. So this is a very popular statement. You might have studied in various books. This is what the meaning. Continuous in time, like we don't have any restriction on time axis and we don't have any restriction on the amplitude axis. That's why continuous in time and continuous in amplitude. But discrete time signal, we say it is continuous in amplitude and discrete or not continuous or discontinuous, discrete in time. I mean, amplitude you don't have any restriction, but in time axis we have restriction. Signal will exist only on the integral multiples. So the motivation to go from this point to this point is that all the DSP processors are not sensitive to these things, and we do these things by samplers. So let's take a break and we'll see the related stuff with